In mid-January 2024, the semiconductor EDA giant Synopsys announced the acquisition of the software firm Ansys for $35 billion. Ansys produces software for computer-aided engineering, or CAE. They have a fascinating history. But why buy it? There's a trend going on here, and it involves this new sexy technical trend of the day, chiplets. In this rather wide-spanning video, we look at the intersection of design and computer simulation. But first, I want to remind you that this video is brought to you by the Asianometry Patreon. Early access members get to see new videos first and selected references for those videos. Early access really helps me a lot, and I appreciate every pledge. Thanks, and on with the show. In the 1960s, John Swanson was working at the Westinghouse Astronuclear Lab in Pittsburgh. He went there to work on nuclear-fueled rockets with the goal of going to Mars, the Nerva nuclear rockets. His work involved doing stress analysis on various components. To do this, Swanson had to model how a structure might function under a particular load. However, trying to mathematically model a big, complicated design was challenging. But if you divide that structure down into smaller pieces, those smaller pieces are easier to predict. Tie those pieces together, and you get a far better idea of how the larger structure will act. This is what we now call finite element analysis, or FEA. In FEA, we break something like a car design down into millions of little shapes and use that to predict how that car design might react if it hits a wall. In those days, the FEA equations had to be worked out by hand using desk calculators, which was long, complicated, and error-prone. So Swanson learned how to code and wrote a few programs to do this FEA. By the late 1960s, it became clear that the nuclear rocket was not going to Mars. So Swanson left, moved back in with his parents, and founded the company Swanson Analysis Systems to develop the Ansys simulation software suite. Westinghouse brought Swanson back as a consultant, which helped Swanson keep food on the table while he coded up Ansys on a time-shared mainframe owned by U.S. Steel. Ansys, Swanson went with the name because the lawyers said it didn't violate anyone's trademark, was finished in 1970, and Westinghouse was the first user. Over time, Swanson and his small team ported the software to mini-computers like the VAX and added crucial features. In 1994, Swanson sold majority control of his company, which had annual revenues of about $30 million, to the private equity firm TA Associates and stepped down. They took the company public 2 years later, changing its name to that of the flagship product. Swanson retired soon after that and has since focused on philanthropy. Ansys's FEA tools have since evolved to embrace a variety of CAE subcategories. Broadly speaking, CAE is about using sophisticated algorithms to simulate, validate, and solve problems in engineering projects. The name is similar to computer-aided design, or CAD, but they're not the same. CAD is for producing the design, while CAE is for testing how that design performs under certain conditions. This is helpful because engineers can now diagnose and troubleshoot problems in a design without having to do as much real-world testing. Since it can cost millions of dollars to build a modern plane or car prototype, and certain conditions cannot be easily replicated in a wind tunnel, this saves a lot of time and money. The rise of more powerful computers, including those within the cloud, has made it more feasible for users to simulate increasingly complicated designs inside a computer. FAE is pretty interesting, and it would be fun to use it to simulate what happens when an integrated circuit hits a brick wall at relativistic speeds, but in a semiconductor industrial context, we want to look at a different major CAE subcategory, computational fluid dynamics, or CFD. CFD programs help solve the complicated nonlinear equations that govern the motion of fluids. Brace yourself for some mind-blowing stuff, but fluids are not like solids. Fluids like air or water react to shear stresses differently than solids because their shapes deform without losing volume, so these fluid dynamics equations are extremely intense. Any calculator, human or otherwise, must simultaneously maintain multiple factors like conservation of mass and momentum in many directions. CFD applies to all sorts of real-world engineering situations, but is particularly big in heat transfer analysis, Engineers can use it to track heat sources in a structure, how that heat conducts or radiates throughout, and how we can carry away that heat using a fluid like air. Considering this, we have long sought ways to model these fluid movements. In 1922, the English scientist and mathematician Lewis Fry Richardson published the book Weather Prediction by Numerical Process. It radically proposed a set of differential equations for predicting the weather. His book also fantasized about the possibility of a, quote, forecast factory, end quote. In it, you would have many dozens of, quote unquote, computers, human computers in this case, calculating these equations for different parts of a world map. This, of course, was a fantasy, but fun nevertheless. By 1940, the available analytical models for modeling fluid dynamics were fragmented and in disarray. Existing models based on older principles proposed by the mathematicians Leonard Euler and Lagrange were elegant, but did not match up with what was happening in reality. This situation changed thanks to the urgency of war. In the waning years of the Manhattan Project, it became crucial for the Americans to track the behavior of shock waves and how they propagated through things. Research continued after the war ended, and hydrogen bomb development began. In 1950, Robert Rickmeyer and John von Neumann published a paper introducing the concept of, quote, artificial viscosity, end quote. This simplified the equations for computers while maintaining fidelity to the basic physics. Over the decade after that, a team at Los Alamos led by Frank Harlow contributed several foundational CFD algorithms like particle in cell or fluid in cell. These works together enabled the foundations of CFD as we know it today. Professor John Chu of Columbia coined the term in 1967, in addition to contributing crucial differential equations for the discipline. CFD programs have since evolved to reproduce and visualize all kinds of thermal dynamics. This is helpful for air conditioning systems, vents, and, interestingly enough, semiconductors. In previous videos, I've talked a bit about the growing trend in advanced packaging. One of the major examples of this is AMD's flagship AI accelerator chip, the MI300. This chip has been built up to be some kind of NVIDIA slayer amongst AMD enthusiasts, but whatever you might think about AMD and NVIDIA, it is a magnificent piece of silicon engineering. I quote Dylan from SemiAnalysis here, "The MI300 is the most incredible form of advanced packaging in the world. Over 100 pieces of silicon stuck together in 3 layers on top of an interposer, which is kind of like a PCB for silicon chips. These silicon pieces are connected using through-silicon vias, which are holes drilled into the die. We can then run copper interconnects through these vias." Advanced packaging techniques like these allow us to produce larger, more powerful pieces of silicon without majorly hurting yields. Certain compute chiplets can be made using advanced nodes, while other, less advanced stuff like I/O can be done in trailing edge fabs. One of the big issues, however, with these vertically stacked semiconductor packages and others like it is heat. Chips generate heat. In a traditional 2D monolithic IC, we know how to deal with this heat. All of the silicon pieces are accessible, so heat generated by the chip can be dissipated out either through the silicon substrate on the bottom or the heat sink on the top. But when you stack more than maybe 2 pieces of silicon together, we can't just throw a big ol' heat sink on top and call it a day. That is because we no longer have access to all of the chips. When you consider that the silicon pieces do not all have the same heat profiles and that heat cannot travel very far, then you end up with local hotspots. These higher temperatures hurt the chip's performance and overall lifetime. I'm compelled to inform you of the fable of the Asian giant hornet. If it ventures too deep into a Japanese beehive, the bees tightly surround the hornet and beat their wings to high temperatures. The poor hornet, which only wants to eat, is cooked to death. Likewise for an advanced packaged IC. Heat from silicon operations or beating bee wings can compromise performance. It can fatigue the soldered interconnects, warp the silicon substrate, or even crack the die entirely. Considering the consequences, it is important that chip designers build structures into their stacked packages to deal with this. The industry has tried several things. There's a whole part of the industry dedicated to heat control. We have silicon or software level measures to take. For instance, writing code to limit the chip's performance so that we don't overheat the package. There are also packaging level things we can do, like immersing the whole chip in a heat dispersing fluid, or even creating silicon fins sticking out from the interposers to shuttle away the heat. There's a strong focus on adapting existing technologies to minimize risk of failure. One example is the solder ball interface between the dies. Changing the filling in between the balls can greatly improve the heat distribution profile of the stack. Regardless of the methodologies employed to deal with the heat, we're going to want to simulate it out to see if it works. A wafer takes about 3 to 5 months to produce, and that does not include packaging. So it could take months to get a complete package to measure, test, and validate its heat profile. But we don't have that much time to wait. Advanced chip design takes far too long as it is. So being able to simulate the thermal profiles of a particular stack design inside a computer without needing to go and build a prototype to test in real life is hugely beneficial. That means CFD. For instance, calculating heat transfers from between two components within a package requires us to know the local fluid temperature, as in the temperature of the parts in contact. But as we established earlier, CFD is extremely difficult to model due to the complicated interplay of various factors. Such programs need to produce accurate results that match within real-world experimentation while also being intuitive to use, since designers are often time-pressured. For this reason, CFD programs for thermal simulations of electronic packages are very mature, around for over 20 years. So semiconductor tool and IP ecosystem providers like TSMC prefer to partner with existing CFD makers like Ansys rather than make their own. In 2021, Ansys announced a partnership with TSMC to deliver a thermal analysis solution for 3D fabric. 3D fabric is TSMC's umbrella of advanced packaging technologies. Import a package from an EDA software, and you can run electrical, thermal, and structural simulations on it. Getting this stamp of approval, as well as others, from the world's biggest foundry is a compelling sign of Ansys' growing presence in semiconductor design. It does make me wonder, though, if we should allow Synopsys to actually buy them. On the surface, the businesses seem quite separate, but Ansys is growing in the industry, and semiconductor design and simulation are soon to collide, especially as generative AI makes its way into the design flow down the line. Simulations can be a way to validate those designs, like how we use a Python runtime to validate ChatGPT's written code. Just a random thought. Maybe I'm crazy. One more thing. I do think that Synopsys being willing to pay $35 billion does say that heterogeneous integration, i.e. the chiplet approach, is here to stay. Expensive AI chips like the MI300 are only the beginning, the leading edge of the sword. I get the feeling that we are going to be seeing the MI300's approach trickle out to almost every part of the semiconductor space, except maybe the smartphone. Considering all the trailing edge semiconductor fab capacity being built around the world right now, users will want to mix and match process nodes and then slap it all together with advanced packaging. This means more complex advanced packages down the line, and that is going to present a lot of challenges because heat isn't the only major thing for packaging designers to overcome. Another one that comes to mind, for instance, is capacitance, which arguably might be harder. This all in turn incentivizes us to produce better tools for designing and manufacturing such advanced package designs. Synopsys is setting out on that journey and putting down $35 billion to back it. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.